They were seen on the most significant missions like Apollo, Skylab and the Space Shuttle. They've been used for the SpaceX Falcon Heavy, and they'll be there on the upcoming SLS missions. But they're hardly ever talked about, and without them, we simply wouldn't be able to get the rockets off the ground. What are they? They were the gateway to the moon and the starting point for every Space Shuttle mission. NASA launch pads 39A and 39B. So what do these massive feats of engineering do, and just how important are they? NASA has over 40 launch pads in various locations, from the US mainland to the Pacific. They're positioned chosen to best get the spacecraft to the correct orbit and to be safely away from population centers. Cape Canaveral in Florida is better for launching spacecraft requiring a west-east orbit, and others like Vandenberg in California are preferred for spacecraft requiring a north-south orbit. But wherever they are, the launch pads themselves are vitally important pieces of equipment for, first and foremost, holding the rocket vertically, which is no mean feat when you consider the size of the Saturn V, which at launch weighed 2,938 tons and stood 17.6 meters taller than the Statue of Liberty at 110 meters, the same as a 36-story building. The launch complex at Cape Canaveral started its rocket career in 1948 after the Naval Air Station there was transferred from the Navy to the Air Force for testing of captured German V2 rockets. This went on to missile testing and rocket technology throughout the 1950s until NASA was formed in 1958 and it became the future for manned and unmanned missions, including Project Mercury and Gemini. In 1961, when President Kennedy announced the moon missions, Cape Canaveral was chosen to be the base for Apollo. This also meant that it would need a massive expansion, with NASA taking an extra 550 square kilometers of land, and the Launch Complex 39 would be designed to handle the most powerful rocket yet designed, the Saturn V. Work started in 1962 and was completed by 1965. There were to be three launch pads, 39A, B and C, and then two more, D and E, later. In the end, only two ended up being built, named 39A, and then just north of that, 39B. Because the area is just above sea level, the flame trenches could not be placed below ground level due to the water table being very close to the surface. So the launch pads were raised by 13 meters and looked like concrete hills. Because of the way NASA designed the Saturn V, there was no permanent launch umbilical tower at the launch pad. That's the part which is next to the rocket at takeoff and supplies it with fuel, electrical power and access for the crew. Instead, the tower was integrated into a mobile launcher platform. The Saturn V would be assembled directly onto the platform along with the tower. This was part of NASA's assembly schedule that meant that the rocket was assembled vertically and then moved with its tower to the launch pad. This contrasts with the Soviets, which assembled their rockets as they lay on their side and then moved them to the launch pad horizontally, where they were then lifted into the vertical position before launch. Now you may well ask, why did NASA choose vertical integration and the Soviets horizontal? Well, when the Saturn was being designed, it was thought that even bigger rockets like the Nova would follow. NASA concluded that it would be easier to assemble the rocket vertically directly onto a mobile launch platform and then move the whole thing to the launch area, rather than assembling it and then moving it on its side and then lifting it up at the launch pad. This was because they thought that the engineering challenges of lifting a 110 meter or larger rocket were just not worth it, and that it would place too much stress on the rocket's body. Now, some of you will be saying that the Soviet N1 was almost as big as the Saturn V, and that was built horizontally and cranked up to the vertical position. But it required a huge, complex mobile structure to lift it, and it was moved on two parallel railway lines with two locomotives. Building the Saturn vertically required the largest single-story building in the world, the VAB, or the Vehicle Assembly Building, which at 160 metres tall is where the new SLS rocket will also be assembled. Built between 1962 and 65, the VAB was capable of preparing up to four Saturn V at the same time, and each of the four doors are the largest in the world to allow a complete Saturn rocket assembly to go out to the launch pad. For Apollo, the pre-built sections of the Saturn V were delivered to the Vehicle Assembly Building from around the US. Here they were stacked on top of each other to form the rocket. On the Saturn V, the rocket was held down to the launch platform by massive hold-down arms, which would release at launch, whereas the shuttle was bolted to the platform through the solid rocket boosters using flangeable nuts. These are nuts which are explosively split at liftoff rather than using explosive bolts. In order to get the rocket and the mobile launcher platform from the VAB to the launch area, there were two crawler transporters which drive under the mobile launch platform, lift it up and then move it to the launch complex. When these 2,700-ton vehicles were delivered in 1965 for the Apollo program, they were the largest self-powered land vehicles in the world. Not only do they carry the rocket and the mobile launcher at about 1.6 kilometers per hour, they also keep the whole assembly level as it ascends the 3% ramp to the launch pad's 39 A and B. Its laser-guided levelling system could keep the top of a Saturn V within 30 centimetres vertically of the base. Once the mobile launch platform had reached the launch pad, it was set down and the crawler transporter returned to the Vehicle Assembly Building. And no, it didn't need to do a massive three-point turn. It could be driven from either end, so it just returned the way it came. Even the road that connects the VAB to the launch pad, known as the crawlerway, had to be specially built with a very low friction surface due to the weight of the rocket, the launcher platform and the crawler, which came in at some 8,165 tons. The material chosen was Alabama River gravel for its unique combination of qualities, and it's still in use today. With the Apollo launches, the Saturn V was attached to the launcher platform and the Launch Umbilical Tower, or LUT. Although it looks like the tower is holding the Saturn up, that was done with hold-down arms at the base of the rocket. The tower was actually there to supply fuel, electrical power, and crew access via the nine service arms, which can be seen swinging away from the rocket at launch. At the top of the LUT was the crew access walkway and the white room, from which the crews would then enter the command module. The pad leader for every manned Apollo mission was Gunter Wendt. He would perform the final checks, strap the crew into the capsule, shake their hands and offer words of support, and then close the hatch. The last major piece of infrastructure was the Mobile Service Structure, or the MSS. This was a large lattice-like platform which was also moved around by the crawlers. At the top of this, which was a little shorter than the launch tower, was a section that would completely enclose the top of the Saturn V and the command module to provide weather protection and access for the technicians, as well as a clean room for preparations before the flight. The mobile service structure was also used to place the linear explosive charges that would separate the stages in flight and the charges along the fuel and oxidizer tanks for fuel dispersion in the event that the rocket had to be destroyed if it veered off course during the launch. The MSS would be moved away from Saturn 8 hours before the launch and was parked between pads 39A and B on the crawlerway when not in use. One of the other jobs that the launcher platform had to do when it was in position was to precisely match up with the pipework for the fuel and electrical supply system, which can be seen running up the side of the LUT. The fuel which the Saturn V used was RP1, a highly refined version of kerosene and LOX, or liquid oxygen. This was used for the first stage, and liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen were used for the second and third stages. This was pumped aboard whilst the Saturn was at the launch pad. Other hypergolic fuels, those that combust on contact with each other, were also pumped aboard at this time, and were for the ignition of the F1 engines and for the lunar lander's descent and ascent engines. In the event of a problem like a major fuel leak whilst the Saturn was being prepared, and providing that it didn't just blow up on the spot, technicians and crews were trained in an escape procedure that used a special high-speed elevator that would get them from the top of the launch tower to the launch platform in under 30 seconds. From here, they would then slide down a 61-meter deceleration slide to the rubber room, some 12 meters under the launch pad, and so called because it was lined with rubber as a shock absorber. This antechamber led via a 15-centimeter thick steel blast door to a dome-shaped blast-proof room mounted on giant springs that was designed to withstand the explosion of a fully fueled Saturn V on the launch pad above. This room could hold up to 20 people, with enough food and water and an air filtration system for 24 hours. Each of the seats could hold a fully suited astronaut until such time that it was safe to leave the room via an escape tunnel that emerged some 366 meters away from the pad. Now, the launch platform under the rocket was not a flat surface. It had a 13.7 meter square blast shielded hole for the rocket exhaust, which allowed it to pass down and over the flame deflector. This double-sided ramp was there to deflect the exhaust and stop it from coming back up and enveloping the rocket. The 13-meter-high ramp, which was covered in flameproof concrete and mounted on rails so it could be more easily replaced, deflected the exhaust down two 18-meter-wide flame trenches, which stretched 174 meters, and were also made from concrete and lined with refractory bricks to protect it from the heat. The huge amount of smoke seen at the launch isn't just rocket exhaust. It's mostly water from the deluge system flashing to steam from the heat of the exhaust. The water was pumped onto the launch pad just before takeoff to help protect the platform and act as an acoustic dampener. In 1974, Launch Pad 39A was decommissioned and was reconfigured for the Space Shuttle. The same also happened to Pad 39B in 1977. The reason for the three-year gap was just in case Congress changed its mind and decided to reinstate the Apollo program. Pad 39B wouldn't be used for the shuttle until 1986, when its first mission was for the ill-fated Challenger STS-51. After the Apollo missions, the mobile launcher platforms were also redesigned for the shuttles. The launch umbilical tower was removed and a permanent two-piece access tower system, the fixed service structure, the FSS, and the rotating service structure, the RSS, were built at the launch pads 39A and B. This new structure also replaced the old mobile service structure. Some of the old structures were preserved, in particular the white room from launch pad 39A, which is now at the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Center. Now just the shuttle stack, that's the shuttle, the SRBs and the external fuel tank, would be carried on the launcher platform. The platform was also modified for the solid rocket boosters, and the exhaust bays were expanded and the flame deflectors were also replaced. As the shuttle was being tested, it became clear that huge acoustic shock waves were bouncing off the launch platform and could endanger both the crew and the delicate insulation tiles of the shuttle. This also occurred during the Apollo launches too, but the Saturn was also much higher up and further away from the engines, and the Saturn didn't have any delicate heat-resistant tiles either. So a new expanded deluge system was also added. This was supplied by a 90-meter-high water tower which held 1.1 million litres of water and ran through twin 2-meter-wide pipes to 16 nozzles that sprayed the water over the launch platform onto the flame deflector. The deluge system would be activated 6 seconds prior to liftoff and would empty the 1.1 million litres of water in around 41 seconds and reduced the sound level by half to about 142 decibels. With these massive metal structures like the Apollo launch tower and the Saturn rocket itself, there was the ever-present danger of lightning strikes hitting a fully fueled rocket or causing electronic failures. To mitigate against this, the Apollo launch tower used a lightning conductor at the top of the tower. This provided a cone of protection for the vehicle and the equipment within it, but the lightning could be still quite close to sensitive electronics. When the shuttle came into service, the electronics had shrunk in size but also became more sensitive. So the lightning conductor was attached to two catenary wires to direct the electrical discharge further away. For the now cancelled Constellation program, it was upgraded once more to the rolling spheres system. Here, three 150-metre towers are topped with 17-metre fiberglass insulators and linked together with multiple catenary wires around the launch pad, which keeps the lightning much further away. After the cancellation of the Constellation program in 2010 and the final flight of the Space Shuttle in 2011, the future of Launch Pad Complex 39 was in doubt. So in 2013, NASA allowed bidding for the first commercial flights from Pad 39A, and a 20-year lease was awarded to SpaceX for the exclusive use of the launch pad. Unlike Apollo and Shuttle, SpaceX rockets were built horizontally and then lifted up at the launch pad, so a new horizontal integration facility was built at Pad 39A. Pad 39B will be used for the SLS system, and that will use the same vertical integration method first used in the Saturn V. And when it's not in use for the SLS, 39B will be available for other commercial launches. In 2015, a new launch pad called 39C was built, and that's for use with smaller launch vehicles. There are also plans for two more launch complexes, LC-48 and LC-49, as the market for commercial space increases and for use with other rockets like the Blue Origin New Glenn. So what's your thoughts about America's gateway to space? Maybe you've worked there or maybe witnessed some of the launches. Let me know in the comments below. So don't forget to check out some of our other space-related videos, and please subscribe, thumbs up, and share.
We have ignition. All engines are running.